light I come week in, week out to prophesy the downfall of this godforsaken kingdom, queendom known as America, right? And the Bible is known by many mystery names, from mystery Sodom, mystery Egypt, to the daughter of Babylon, right? Because, hey, the Bible is a book that must be spiritually discerned. And only one people, one nation, has the ability to unlock the mysteries that are found within this Bible. Right? You won't find the name America in the Bible. You won't find the people classified as black as far as their nationality in the Bible or white. Right? But this is why it's incumbent for one-third of the elect of the nation of Israel to come into the knowledge, as is prophesied that they will. Right? Because in this time, a lot of our people, to the tune of two-thirds, are without knowledge of who they are in the earth. They don't know what their purpose is. They don't even know that they are in the land of their captivity as a form of a punishment, right? And with them not even knowing who they are and why they're here, of course they don't have any hope of their condition changing, right? Because the condition of so-called blacks, Latinos, and Native Americans, if you subscribe to these misnomers, bywords, and proverbs, hey, you're still, like it says in Proverbs 21 and 16, in the congregation of the dead, right? You're dead to your true biblical nationality. You're dead to your true heritage, right? It said that in Jeremiah, I believe, 17 and 4, right? It said that we'll discontinue from our heritage, right? And we have a very goodly, rich heritage, and that's found in the Bible, right? Our victories, our triumphs, as well as our failures, right? It's throughout different dispensations of time, throughout different captivities, right? This being the worst captivity that we've ever had to endure, but hey, this is not our first, this is the worst. Because our people were in ancient Egypt, our people were in Babylon, our people were in Rome, our people were in Assyria, right? But in this present time, our people, for the majority, are found within the confines of Babylon, right? Babylon, a compound word, right? Babel means confusion. 1 Corinthians 14 and 33 lets us know that God is not the author of confusion. But two-thirds of our people, they are in a confused state, right? This is called the land of confusion, right? The valley of the shadow of death, right? This is the state of affairs. This is the order of the day. This is the environment that our people are in. But they don't have knowledge of who they are. They don't have a knowledge of their power. And they don't even have a knowledge that they are here to serve a punishment. And this is to denote them being in a confused state, right? Hey, but that's what we come out here to do. We come out here to exalt, magnify, and reverence the name of Yahweh, Bahashem, Yahweh Shai. Right? Yahweh, that's the God of the Bible, the God of the Israelites. He has a proper name because that word God in Hebrew simply means Allah. And there are many gods, but the God of the Bible, the God that Son, who the world ignorant called Jesus Christ, right? Who we know is Yahweh Shai HaMashiach, right? This is the true biblically sound image. We don't worship this image, but when our Lord and Savior came humbly, like it says in Genesis 49 and 11, right, when he came humbly over 2,000 years ago, he didn't come in the image of a so-called white man, right, but rather a revolutionary so-called black Messiah, right, that was hated without a cause, right, handed over to the Romans by his people, the Israelites, right, but he said, when he come back, he will not meet us as a man, but rather a spiritual force, right? And that spiritual force is coming back to bring judgment on two-thirds of even our people, as pursuant to Zechariah 13 and 8. But salvation to that one-third of Israel, not only found in the confines of Babylon, but as well is around the four corners of the earth. Because that's a mystery that's found in the Bible, right? This is why we are known as prisoners of hope in the book of Zechariah 9 and 12, right? Because we can lean on these prophecies, right? Israel has always required a sign, but this is more than enough for us to hold on to our faith and match our faith with works in hopes that, hey, what is written will come to pass. And we know this book is true because no other book has prophecies that tell us who we are. No other book on the planet has prophecies that tell us who we are, how we got into this condition, and how we're going to get out of this condition, right? Therefore, hey, that's more than what we need, right? redeeming the times, like it says in Romans 13 and 11. It's high time to wake out of sleep, because our salvation is nearer than we believe. Why? Because we're measuring the time diligently, looking at what's going on in geopolitics, socioeconomic, with our people, right? Spiritually, and most of all, prophecy, to see how close we are to the Heavenly Father sending His Son as a destructive force and as a redemptive force to reconcile us back with the Father, right? Hey, and I don't want to go any further unless I give double honors to the elders and apostles of Great Millstone. Through the power and spirit of Yahweh, Yahweh Shai, those are the men that have been endowed with the knowledge, wisdom, and understanding to reconcile the children back with the Father, right? Double honors to the elders and apostles of Great Millstone that teach and rule well, and many blessings to you brothers that are laboring in truth, faith, and sincerity across the four corners of the earth, right? Right now, I'm back on the west end of Atlanta, and for the most part, the truth has gone out into the earth, right? It said that in Matthew, the 24th chapter, that this gospel will be preached throughout all the earth. The gospel, the good news, will be preached throughout all the earth, and then the end will come, right? Why? Because the Most High is still merciful, right? Even though we see His judgments roll out in the earth every day, we see how His arms are long to protect and be merciful and show favor to those that trust and have faith and believe in Him, right? So this is what we want to do, just jump right into the scriptures. Lord willing, this be edifying, right? I'm going to start off with Zechariah 9 and 12, because right now, we're prisoners of hope, as I stated. And what is our hope in? Our hope is in, that rock. This is our comforter. This tells us exactly how we're going to be redeemed out of this lower state, right? Lord willing, we are among the elect that are slated to be saved out of this impending destruction, because America is a vast graveyard, right, that was built on the blood of the saints. Numbers 35 and 33 lets you know that blood defiles the land, and the land cannot be cleansed of that blood that's been shed but by the assailant, right? The perpetrator, his blood must be shed, right? So that lets you know that America, right, Babylon the Great, chiefly, is facing a great, great, great judgment in the earth, right? And one of the things that a majority of our people never even consider is, if America is going to be destroyed, and I live in America, right, I can't leave America without passports and permissions, how am I going to be saved, right? This is the good news, right? This is why this is called the good news, right? Let me start off. This is the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter 4, verse 3, and it reads, "But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them." Right? But it said, but if this gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost. Right? Right now in the earth, across the four corners of the earth, as pursuant to Matthew 22 and 9, Luke 14 and 23, the Lord has commanded the prophets to go on the highways and hedges to compel our people to come into the house, right, to get themselves in order, to prepare their garments, which is, their righteousness, right, them doing their level best to die daily, to rehearse the righteous acts, get their garments clean, because it said that He's coming back for a church without spot or wrinkle, right? And you will not get into the wedding ceremony without the proper garments. This is basically what we're telling our people to do, right, like it says in Matthew 22 and 9. Let me bring this out one more time. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 3 reads, "But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost." It said, if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost. If this good news that, you are not just relegated to be a perpetual slave underneath these heathens round about, if that's not good news to you, right, if the so-called white man going headlong back into slavery, if that's not good news to you, if you call that hate speech, you're blinded by the light of Esau Edom, the so-called white man. His true biblical nationality is found in the Bible, right? They're not white, but rather red, right? This is a mystery. This is a part of the gospel, right? This is what eludes the majority of our people. Why? Because they are lost because the God of this world, Esau Edom, right? Job 9 and 24 lets us know the earth has been given into the hand of the wicked. Right? He controls all facets of society, from the school's curriculum to the media, right, to imagery, right? Iconoclasm, as far as the different icons and the different busts of so-called blacks around the world. Hey, he erected so-called white people in their place. Anything representing righteousness, uprightness, right, power, right? You don't see so-called blacks, Latinos, and Native Americans sitting, representing it, right? Because they the so-called white man. This was given to him, the authority, right? The bounds that he's still operating in. Hey, the Most High has actually extended him that power. So-called white supremacy. You know, it said that in Romans 13. You know, the powers that be are ordained of the Most High, right? Ordained of the Most High, right? His hatred towards us is perpetual, the so-called white man, as pursuant to Ezekiel 35 and 5. But his time to rule over us, that's what is not perpetual, right? They said that in the book of Job. His bounds have been appointed that he cannot pass. Why? Because there's something more powerful than the so-called white man, right? And that's what it says in the book of Romans. Our people worship and fear the creature more than the creator, right? Their fear is misappropriated. They fear the creature more than their creator. This is why the Most High has given them over to a reprobate mind. This is why 2/3 of our people can be cut off and die. Hey, because they never came to the love of the truth. They never came into the knowledge that, hey, God has not given us a spirit of fear. But what it said, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, wisdom and understanding in the book of Proverbs. Right? Our people just need to appropriate the fear into the right places. Right? Because, hey, a majority of our people, they fear the so-called white man. Right? More than they fear their creator, Yahweh, and his son, Yahweh Shai. Right? They fear losing in this life, not understanding that you can have perpetual shame by not being upright in this life. You'll wake up to everlasting shame even in the kingdom, right? But this is what eludes 2/3 of our people. Why? Because they're blinded. Let me bring this out one more time. 2 Corinthians 4:3. But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them, right? It said he's blinded the minds of them that believe not, right? The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. It said that in Jeremiah 17:9. That's why Proverbs 3:5 says, trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not on thine own understanding, right? If you're not operating within the realm of the scriptures and the understanding of the scriptures, hey, all you have to lean on is one of Esau's different cups of wine. You know, one of Esau's different schools of thought. One of Esau's different pseudosciences. Because, hey, it says, wide is the way that leads to destruction. Hey, but narrow is the way that leads to truth, right? And it says that even in the scriptures, seek ye the old path, where is the good way? And do what? Walk therein. Right? Let me see if I can get that real quick. I believe it's Jeremiah 6:16. Right? But our people, they want to try to shake their way through this situation. They don't want to submit. You know, and this is why the scripture has said, in their affliction, they will seek me early. Why? Because, hey, Jacob's a bullshit artist, but once his affliction comes, that hour of judgment, right? Then they are going to try to bullshit, right? And the Most High knows the spirit of his people, right? This is the book of Jeremiah 6:16, and it reads, thus said the Lord, stand ye in the way, and seek, and ask for the old path, where is the good way, and walk therein, and ye shall find rest for your souls. But they said, we will not walk therein, right? A majority of our people, right? He commanded his prophets to go out, right? Stand ye in the way and see, and ask for the old path, where is the good way, and walk therein, and ye shall find rest for your soul. Right? Micah 2:10 says, arise and depart, for this is not your rest. This is why this is our hiding place. This is our comfort. This is where you will find rest until the Most High comes to judge this place and set us back as the praise of the earth. That's when we'll enter into our rest. But as far as right now, we have a place to lay down and find rest, to find comfort, right? Gold and rubies and diamonds, sweet as honey. Hey, we have access to it right now, right? So we have hope, and our hope is not just based upon nothing, but it's based upon prophecies. And there are prophecies that have come to pass to let us know, hey, that we're on the right track, right? The Most High loves us. He hasn't forgotten about us. And the more these prophecies begin to roll out in the earth, hey, that strengthens our resolve to know that, hey, this book is true, living and breathing. People say, hey, y'all are, you know, still living in the Bible days. Let me tell you, we are living in the last days, because there are still prophecies in this Bible that have yet to come to pass. So yes, we're still living in the Bible days, right? The so-called white man going back into captivity, right? The C-hip, the so-called mark of the beast, where people won't be able to buy, sell, or trade. You know, Jeremiah, I believe it's 30:7, talks about Jacob's trouble, when our people are gonna have to face some of the worst circumstances and conditions than when we've ever been in captivity, right? This is all what's coming down the pipeline, not only for America, but also for the whole house of Israel, right? The elect are gonna be brought through the fire. We're gonna be refined through whatever situations we go through. It says that in the book of Zechariah 13:8. But the starting point is what? Starting that path, the old path, where is the good way? Even when I was young, there was always a picture, this Christian picture of footprints in the sand, right? Basically, everything we need to do, the path has been laid out. You just have to come to the point where, hey, you make your body a living sacrifice. It says that in the book of Romans 12. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, that ye present your bodies as a living sacrifice, right? Because it says that in Ecclesiastes 12:13, right? The conclusion of the whole matter is for us to fear the Lord and keep his commandments, right? And the commandments is to do what? Be obedient, right? Even if it comes down to sacrificing your body, right? You got to throw caution to the wind and fear the Lord and be obedient and know that he's with you. Why? Because he said he'll never leave us or forsake us, right? He said that he's always with us, right? Let me go ahead and bring out another precept based on that old path. Where is the good way, right? Because, hey, wide is the way that leads to destruction. This is what we understand, right? There are so many ways that you can get knocked off the path. It says that, you know, Satan, like a roaring lion, that's what he wants to do. He seeks to not only destroy us, but hey, knock us off of our path, right? Then the Most High, just like in the book of Job, the first chapter, the Most High will allow this to happen. Why? Because his elect are going to do exactly what he's put in their spirit to do. No matter what conditions may arise, we're not going to forsake the Most High. We're not going to lose faith, right? Because it says that in the book of Hebrews, without faith it's impossible to please our power. This is the whole reason why we were put down in these chains of darkness, right? So that, hey, we could get away from that old man, become new creatures, be refined, and hey, be redeemed, right? They say that in the book of Luke 1:68, Acts 5:29. Redemption is for Israel exclusively, right? And our Redeemer lives. This is a part of the good news. This is why we come out faithfully, for free, in the four corners of the streets to tell our people that, hey, it's gonna get greater later, but you must have faith and you must accompany your faith with works. And have faith in what? Have faith in the Holy Scriptures, because hey, this is where to lose the majority of our people, right? They look at this as a so-called white man's religion, right? They don't find interest in the Bible. They associated with their grandmothers and their grandfathers in plantation Christianity, right? And which is totally understandable why they are disenchanted with the Bible, because they associated with those 501c3 whorehouses, those harlot houses. But this is why the Lord has his men out on the highways and hedges, so we could counter all of the lies. This is why the Lord, Yahweh, why Yahweh Shai, has his men out on the highways and hedges, so we could tear down strongholds, right? There are certain aspects of the Bible that these men, right, these prosperity pimps, these greedy dogs, they won't touch on as it pertains to the Bible. Judgment, hate, you know, Esau, they're not going to touch on it. But this is why the Most High sent his prophets out early, right? It says that in the book of Proverbs 1 and 20, it said, wisdom shall be found in the streets, right? So you can't say that, hey, I can't afford to go to a theological seminary. I can't afford to go to this Bible college. I can't afford to buy this breakdown package from IUIC. Hey, the Most High has his men out, and not only that, Proverbs 20 and 24 lets you know that man's comings and goings are of the Lord. The Most High orders steps, it says that in Proverbs 16 and 9 as well. So, hey, he gives people over to a reprobate mind, which means he rejects. There are certain people that he has seared their conscience with a hot iron, right? They won't get the word, and hey, they're so defiled that he's rejected them. They're just filling up their iniquity to his measure until he cuts them off, right, in the land of their captivity. Right, it said that in Zechariah 13 and 8, two-thirds shall be cut off and die. But hey, the elect has said, my sheep shall hear my voice. If you are pre-selected, preordained to receive this knowledge, there's nothing that you can do to run from your purpose, right? Because I speak to brothers and I ask them about their lives before they came into the truth. I ask brothers about their origin stories, how they came into the truth. And you'll be surprised. So many brothers weren't raised by Israelite mothers and fathers in the land of Judea. We didn't go to Hebrew school and we weren't raised in Demona, Israel. But by hook or by crook, the Most High awakened their spirit. He breathed the breath of life into them. And now, hey, they're living, breathing spirits, resuscitating other people around them. But they never would have thought in 1,000 years that they would make this their life's vocation, that this would be their chief love, their chief desire, to not only please, exalt, and magnify the name of Yahweh, why Yahweh Shah, but also their vocation to serve him as far as their purpose, going out into the streets and within their families, within their personal lives, and represent righteousness, represent a kingdom to come. Right? But it's all through the will of Yahweh, why Yahweh Shah, being merciful unto us, to not just relegate us to the status of a two-bit nigga out here in these streets. I look at how a majority of our people carry themselves, right? Their lewd conversation, their desires and their aspirations, right? Yahweh, why Yahweh Shah is nowhere in their thoughts, nowhere in their mind, and that's scary. Because at any given time, that judgment could fall on them and they wouldn't even know how to cry out to the Most High. They wouldn't know what name to use, right? So hey, the Wadi Yahweh for waking up his elect. And as more men that's pursuing the Revelation 7 and 4, Revelation 7 and 9, right? It talks about that 144,000, 12,000 out of every tribe, as well as that great multitude that no man could number, of scattered Israelites coming back into the fold, right? But that lets you know, as pursuing the prophecy, it's already sealed. Not a matter of if, but when are these men going to come back into the knowledge of who they are? Hey, and usher in a more righteous, a more profitable kingdom, right? We know that according to prophecy that this is going to come to pass, right? But as far as when, hey, it says no man know the day, no man knows the hour, right? But this is why we should constantly be doing things to benefit the kingdom, to magnify our power, Yahweh Shah. Because, hey, that's a part of redeeming the time, right? You want to be found occupied. You want to be found doing, knowing that, hey, we're in the 11th hour of judgment for Babylon, right? If not if, but when. Right, we already see what's going on in geopolitics, as far as Russia, as far as these proxy wars, as far as Japan, as far as the dollar losing its prominence on the global front. Right, all wars are bankers' wars. We saw what happened to Muammar Gaddafi and Saddam Hussein when they wanted to back up their oil. Not with an American petrodollar, but with their gold. Hey, the central bankers, hey, they rolled down on them. Hey, but this is all a scheme by the elite, right? The Hegelian dialectic. problem, reaction, solution. Order out of chaos. Because we've been coming out for years letting our people know that it's going to be a new world order. What's going to change is this monetary system. This is what the elite plan, right? They want to take away your ability to use paper money, fiat currency, right? Debt. And they want you to basically take a mark wherein you will be buying and selling and trading using this mark, right? Revelation 13 and 16 lets you know that this is a digital reset, right? When you look at 4G, 5G technology, when you look at the chip readers, right? When you look at different ways that they're perfecting and they're moving forward with RFID, NFC technology, hey, blockchain, even when it comes down to ankle monitors and things of that nature, right? They're already coming up with the technology, whereas you will be governed, right? You will be monitored, you will be surveillanced, right? By the powers that be, right? The elite, right? So this is exactly what we come out here to tell our people, right? They need to prepare their spirits because, hey, just like in Revelation 13 and 16, it said that all men, rich, poor, free, bond, they're going to have to be confronted with, hey, am I going to put my trust in Yahweh or am I going to just go along with the order of the day for you all to, you know, basically tattoo my skin, right? Make an incision in my skin so that you can monitor my purchases, monitor my location, right? Even if it comes down to your medical records, they can see when the last time you got a certain inoculation, when the next time you'll need one, different restrictions and things of that nature. I mean, full-on control. But a majority of our people aren't mindful. Why? Because, hey, they are not walking in that old path. Where is the good way? So they're in a confused state, like it says in 1 Corinthians 14 and 33. Right? It said God is not the author of confusion. But, hey, the God of the Bible isn't reigning over two-thirds of these people. So they don't have any answers. Right? Let me go ahead and bring this out in the book of Esdras. Right? As it pertains to that old path. Right, this is 2nd Esdras, chapter 6, and I'm going to start with chapter 7 and verse 6, and it reads, all right, there's also another thing, a city that is building, is set upon a broad field, and is full of good things. The entrance thereof is narrow, and is set in a dangerous place to fall, like as if there were fire on the right hand, and on the left a deep water. And only one path between them both, even between the fire and the water, so small that there could but one man go there at once. Reading on. If this city now were given to a man for an inheritance, if he never shall pass the danger set before it, how shall he receive this inheritance? And I said, it is so, Lord. Then said he unto me, even so is also is Israel's portion. Right? Israel's portion as well. Right? So just staying on that path. I was speaking about how Satan wants to sift men out of the truth. He wants you to drop the plow. He wants you to question your faith and give up. Right? Which is basically getting you off the path. And here in 2nd Esdras 7 and 6, it was an analogy for the kingdom of heaven. It's saying that the entrance to the kingdom of heaven is narrow, so narrow that can only one man pass at a time, which lets you know that camps and brothers is not going to go into the kingdom together. You're going to be judged on your own merit as an individual, right? The Heavenly Father is going to judge individuals, right? Another man's righteousness can't cover you, right? But it said that the entrance is so narrow, and on one side is water and one side is fire. Right, that water is representing the, you know, different doctrines, different philosophies that might come about to take you away from the true knowledge of the Bible. Right, and that fire represents all the things that can arise in his life. You know what I mean? To knock you off the path. Because in Zechariah 13 and 8, that fire is actually a refining agent. You know, a refining agent. But here, let me bring this out one more time. There's also another thing, a city that is building and is also set in a broad field and is full of good things, right? This is the kingdom of heaven. It said the entrance thereof is narrow and is set in a dangerous place to fall. As if there were water, there were fire on the right hand and a deep water on the left hand. So just imagine, you know, you are walking a narrow entrance to safety, peace, harmony, right? But on one side is fire, and on the other side is the deep water. That represents this captivity. That represents the different challenges and obstacles that are necessary for us to go through before we inherit all of those good things that are ready for us to partake in. Because in our Father's house, there are many mansions, right? That represents, you know, when we get our glorified bodies, us having access to not only this planet, but to other solar systems, galaxies within this universe, right? It says, eyes have not seen or ears have heard what good things. It's not even within our realm of our imagination. It's nothing that we can reference it to that is gonna compare to what's in store for us, right? And this is why forsaking this world for the world to come is so pinnacle. Forsaking this world, our people have been totally deceived and totally conditioned to think that this world has something to offer us. But all it does is pervert us, defile us, you know, further put us at odds with our power. It further puts us at odds with our power, right? The ways of this world, right? This is why the scripture said, if you love this world, right, you can't love the Heavenly Father. You can't serve two masters, right? And this is a part of the refining process for the elect, right? As they continue to go into, you know, closer into that hour of temptation, going to the judgment of Babylon, hey, the Most High is just going to continue to refine us. And the things that we go through, we're going to come out on the other side more faithful, more obedient, you know, more submissive to the ways of our power. You see what I'm saying? So the two-thirds, they're just going to continue to slip off into damnation, right? Let me bring this out in the book of Zechariah 13 and 8 as it pertains to two-thirds of Israel and their judgment, right? Lord willing, I'm not among a two-thirds, right? That's why I said the hopeful elect, like it says in Zechariah 9 and 12, right? Zechariah 13 and 8, Selah, right? So, yeah, Zechariah 9 and 12 talks about the hopeful elect. All right, let me bring this out in the book of Zechariah 13 and 8, because I was just talking about the refining process, right? Zechariah 13 and 8 reads, and it shall come to pass that in all the land, saith the Lord, two parts therein shall be cut off and die, but the third part shall be left therein. And I will bring the third part through the fire, and I will refine them as silver is refined, and I will try them as gold is tried. They shall call on my name, and I will hear them, and I will say, it is my people, and they will say, the Lord is my power. But verse 9, let me read this again. And I will bring the third part through the fire, and I will refine them as silver is refined. Right? So fire is a refining agent. We just brought that out in 2nd Ezra 7 and 6. Right? If this kingdom be built, the narrow is so entry, but what's on one side? Fire. And on the other side, a deep water. So as the elect continue to stay on that path, like it said in Jeremiah 16 and 6, Jeremiah 6 and 16, rather, it says, seek ye the old path, where is a good way? Right? 2nd Ezra 7 and 6 let you know that narrow path, right, that straight gate, hey, it's full of obstacles and ways for you to fall. But with that fire being there, if you proceed and you don't fall, you're going to be refined. That silver is refined. Refined, that gold is refined. You see that? Let me bring this out in the book of Zechariah 9 and 12. Right? Zechariah 9 and 12, because, hey, our hope is in the rock. Our hope is in something tangible. You know, it'll be different if the Bible didn't contain prophecies that hadn't come to pass. Then we'll have blind hope. We'll have blind faith. But hey, the Most High has shown us his face so many times that we know he's a true and living power. The Bible is a living and breathing book, and we are yet in the Bible days. Why? Because there are prophecies that are written therein that have yet to come to pass, right? This is the book of Zechariah chapter 9 in verse 12, and it reads, "Turn ye to the stronghold, ye prisoners of hope. Even today do I declare that I will render double unto thee." Right? Here it is, Zechariah 9 and 12. The house of Israel are referred to as prisoners of hope. But it said that he will render double unto us. So what's been done to us by the so-called white man, chiefly Esau, Edom, written up in the Bible, as well as these other nations round about, hey, they're prescribed to receive double for what they've done to us. Right? So if they smack us one time, what will be reciprocated is them being smacked two times. Right? That is the penalty for the crime. Right? Zechariah 9 and 12. "Turn ye to the strongholds, ye prisoners of hope. Even today do I declare that I will render double unto thee. When I have bent Judah for me, filled the bow with Ephraim, and raised up thy sons, O Zion, against thy sons, O Greece, and made thee as a sword of a mighty man." Right? It said that he's going to raise up the sons of Zion against the sons of Greece. Right? The sons of Zion being so-called blacks, Latinos, and Native Americans, as well as those that are scattered across the four corners of the earth, against the sons of Greece. Right? The modern-day Grecians, the modern-day Romans, are the so-called white men. I wouldn't give a damn if he called themselves American, French, Russian, right? The whole house of Esau, even Amalek, right? They represent Greece, right? And it says explicitly that the Most High is going to raise us up against them. He's not going to come down and issue a judgment, but rather he's going to pour the Spirit on his people, Israel, to execute all the judgments that are written, right? Zechariah 9 and 12, once again, "When I have bent Judah for me, filled the bow with Ephraim, and raised thy sons, O Zion, against thy sons, O Greece, and made thee as the sword of a mighty man." Right? Let me get this in Isaiah 41 and 14. Hey, he said, "Ye are my battle axe and weapons of war." I'm going to get that as well. But it's telling you explicitly, right? We're prisoners of hope, but we see clearly who are the sons of Greece. Who are the sons of Zion? Right? Because Matthew 13 and 10 lets you know that it's given unto us to know the mysteries that are found in the Bible. But unto these other 17 nations of heathen that come out of Adam, it is not given. Right? But this is a mystery. Who are the sons of Zion? Who are the sons of Greece? Because the majority of our people are operating within this paradigm of fictional Crayola colors. Right? Identifying themselves by misnomers, proverbs, and bywords, derogatory terms that do not denote who you truly are as far as your biblical nationality. Right? Let me get this in Isaiah. I said 41 and 14. Right? Because he said he's going to make us as a sword of a mighty man. All right? This is Isaiah chapter 41 and verse 14. And it reads, "Fear not, thou worm Jacob, and ye men of Israel. I will help thee, saith the Lord, and thy Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. Behold, I will make thee a new sharp threshing instrument having teeth. Thou shalt thresh the mountains and beat them small, and thou shalt make the hills a shaft." Right? This goes right into the sons of Zion going against the sons of Greece. Right? Those mountains represent what? Larger governments. But the Most High is not going to come out of the sky and judge these nations, but rather he's going to put the Spirit on his people. Right? To do what? Be as a sharp threshing instrument having teeth. To do what? Hey, let me bring this out one more time. "Fear not, thou worm Jacob, and ye men of Israel." Right? This is the audience that the Most High has always addressed in the Bible.